So now, presenting what Martin Luther King Jr. would say about the ethical culture movement, please welcome Abe Markman.
Thanks, Andrew, so much. And thank you all for coming on a holiday weekend. I'll try to make it worthwhile. Or we will. I want to give a special welcome to my family and friends. I want to also thank all the people who influenced my thinking, especially Dr. Phyllis Harrison Ross and the others on the panel, Nicole DeMarco and Barbara Fennell, and for editing draft after draft, my dearest friend, Virginia Arnold. This has been more of a process than a one-time event, and it will not end this morning. Today we're going to talk about racial and ethnic diversity and open a conversation about the effects of hidden biases. In short, it is diversity promotion and bias control. You can't have one without the other. Sounds like a song, doesn't it? This discussion will include an imagined visit by Martin Luther King and questions I will ask you and personal stories about facing our own biases. So here is Martin Luther King on ethical culture. I want to applaud the ethical culture movement for its most impressive record of social justice achievements. Although I am gratified that my I Have a Dream speech has had an impact, what many people forget is that I had something else to say that year, 1963. I said that 11 a.m. on Sunday morning is the most segregated hour in America. 50 years later, it still is. With that in mind, I also applaud your efforts to welcome like-minded people of color through your doors. I'm referring to your team leadership group and how they revel in their multicultural membership. And despite my Christian beliefs, I recognize the value to your society of your leader, Ann Clayson's reaching out to the African-American humanists and atheists. The fact that you have established the Dr. Phyllis Harrison Ross Award for Public Service with David Dinkins as the first awardee sends a clear message that African Americans are welcome here. Also, considering that the Ethical Culture School has hired a diversity specialist, should be a model for all schools. Regarding the wider ethical culture movement, your Philadelphia Society recently held a workshop on Can We Talk About Race? And the Brooklyn Ethical Culture Society held a platform of poetry written by members about the Trayvon Martin case. I believe the efforts you make might not result in more people of color joining your society anytime soon, but you'll be sending a message far and wide that the New York Society for Ethical Culture acts with resolve to fulfill its philosophy of community and inclusion. In regard to the controlling of hidden biases, I first want to acknowledge an unintended consequence of the civil rights movement. It was, and is still true, that even people who were in the forefront of the civil rights struggle began to feel guilty when they realized that they themselves harbored stereotypes or biases based on skin color. Though these biases cannot be easily removed, they can't be controlled. If this fact is widely accepted, It could lead to a new era in improved interracial and interethnic relationship building. So congratulations on a record in civil and human rights rarely matched in longevity and in results. Andrew just mentioned a few to save time, but the record of this society is enormous. Thank you, and I wish you all well in your endeavors. No.
Oh.
If you believe, if you want, you can clap for Martin Luther King or for me. As a tribute to Martin Luther King, a few members of Ethical Culture and I are preparing a list of cultural exchanges that we hope the program committees of the societies will consider in planning their annual programs. Now it is your turn to weigh in. We don't have an enormous amount of time, so I can't just open the questions up. I have to ask these specific questions. To those of you who are familiar with my article, Overcoming Hidden Biases, please help me explain some of it to those who haven't read it. I have two questions. Number one, should anyone feel ashamed for having a bias against people with a different skin color? If anyone has read the article, would you want to take a chance on answering it? Bernie?
No.
Why?
I didn't know you were asking why.
You're right. Yeah.
Well, I guess I'll just say that I come from Massachusetts. I come from a small suburban town, and I didn't know any black people when I was growing up, and because I grew up in a society that is racist, I have that within me. And I am ashamed of it, I'll be honest, but I acknowledge it, and that's really all I have to say.
Thank you, Bernie. That's a lot. That's a lot to say.
Does anybody else have something to say? No, no more confessions? Oh, here we go.
I don't have to confess.
I have a bias over trench coats to blazers. So, I mean, there's always bias.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, we're concentrating on a specific kind of bias, but there are all kinds, and this Project Implicit, where the research that I've done comes mostly from Project Implicit, and I'll tell you how to look it up later on. But they test you on almost any kind of bias imaginable. It's amazing how many we carry around, some we know about, some we hide. Anyone else want to say anything about it?
Pat's going to talk.
Well, I think one of the things you pointed out in the article, Abe, was that we absorb that prejudice when we're very young, before we have the objective, you know, ability to question whether it is valid or not. And that's why we can hold hidden biases that we as adults don't approve of.
Thank you, that's very clear.
There's somebody over here.
I think in your article, you mentioned that it's really like an unconscious absorption of what's going on around us. I know I grew up in an area where everybody was white, except for one family, and the it was a mother and children, and the mother had a very menial job, And in my school, there was a lot of segregation going on as far as the areas that people that the kids came from. So that really is embedded in me. But I'll tell you, the thing that helped me get over it the most, and I think I've gotten over it to a large degree. Oh, one other thing is that you said in your article that when we do confront these prejudices, we have to wait. You know, make sure that we wait and count to 10 or whatever it takes to rethink it and say, hey, you know, that's not what this is all about. This is a person, and you know, I want to know this person. That person is what her experience is, her or his experience is. But I'm working with children. I worked in many schools that were, you know, either integrated or, you know, very diverse or completely black. And that was really a revelation to me. I'm working with kids to get over it.
Thanks.
Thanks. I'm going to cut off the questions now. Okay. Or do you want more?
No, I think we better go on if this is another question.
Okay.
I think you all answered it very well, so I don't have to say anything about it. The second question is, can people with a social justice belief system harbor biases against people who have a different skin color than oneself?
Do that one again.
Yeah.
Can people with a social justice belief system harbor biases against people who have a different skin color than themselves?
Are you saying people that are actually in the business of making sure there's social justice, can they themselves harbor biases? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, what?
They themselves harbor biases.
Yes.
Well, here we go.
The questions are simpler than they ought to be. I dare say everyone in this room is not a racist and is aware of the ills of racism. That does not mean that they don't, to use your word, harbor or have the so-called hidden biases. And of course it's a matter of shame to have something that you disapprove of. But that's the way the human being is. The important thing is having them, is to recognize that and work against it. And that is the challenge we have, to be conscious of it, to be aware of it, and to at all times studiously resist it and act differently and point it out to others, no matter where on the spectrum of racism they may be. But it is something to be ashamed of, or whatever word you want to use. It is not a desirable trait. And some of us, or I dare say all human beings, are not perfect and do things they don't approve of.
Okay, thanks. Again, to save time, could we show a video that explains this point very well, I think.
2, 1.
Michaela is a seventh grader at a majority white middle school. The responses completely change depending on the race of the children in the picture.
Marcy and Renee are in school together and they're in the hallway, and I'd like you to tell me what you think is happening in this picture.
She probably looks like she's gonna steal it because Marcy's like, oh no, what happened? And he's like, hey look, $20. And so, do you think that Renee is doing something good, bad, or just neutral?
I think she's gonna take it.
Do you think that Renee and Marcy are likely to be friends or not?
Not really.
And what do you think about Marcy's parents? Do you think they'd be comfortable with her being friends with Renee or not?
Well, if they find out the situation that happened, they might be a little concerned about if Renee's a thief.
Mm-hmm. And this one we have Erica and Allison, and they're also in the hallway at school. Can you tell me what it seems is happening in this picture?
Allison looks like a sweet girl, mm-hmm. So I think that she would pick up Erica's money and give it back to her.
Okay, so then do you think Allison's doing something good, bad, or neutral?
Pretty good.
And what about Allison and Erica? Do you think they're probably friends or not so much?
Yeah, they're probably friends.
Okay. Do you think Erica's parents would like it if she was friends with Allison?
Yeah.
Her responses, according to our expert, Dr. Melanie Killen, could indicate a subconscious racial bias, a bias that kids develop from messages they hear at school, at home, the characters in the TV shows they watch, and what they see online. And Michaela's reversing the scenarios based on race wasn't unique. 24%, almost a quarter of all children, both white and African American, saw their own race more positively than the other race. And this happened across all ages and all school types, no matter the racial demographics.
What do you think happened in this picture?
They got a poster.
And what do you think is going to happen then?
Brandy's going to hop over this.
So do you think that Randy's doing something that's okay, not okay, or kind of in the middle?
Not okay.
Not okay? Is Andre doing something good, bad, or just okay?
Good.
Michaela's answers were very much in line with her. Michaela's parents, Jim and Jennifer, agreed to watch their daughter's test and talk about her responses.
Well, if they find out the situation that happened, they might be a little concerned about if Renee's a thief.
Mm-hmm.
Allison looks like a sweet girl. Mm-hmm. So I think that she would pick up Erica's money and give it back to her.
When you see that, what goes through your mind? I mean, is there a conversation you want to have with her? Is there stuff you want to know more about?
I would definitely want to pursue that conversation with her and find out why her perception was different based upon the color of the girl's skin. What changed in that scenario in her head?
It's a teachable moment. It's a, you know, it's a realization like, oh, maybe we have to do, you know, a better job or focus more on distinguishing like about racism and you know, diversity. And just influence our kids and let them know that you have to judge a person by their character, not their skin color.
And it's this possible subconscious racial bias versus explicit bias, actually consciously thinking and verbalizing racism, that our expert says shows how far we need to go, but also how far we've come.
Explicit racism and prejudice has diminished dramatically over 50 years, but what remains is more the implicit. The implicit biases and the implicit forms of racism and prejudice, and those are the things that we're not aware of. The things that we do and we don't realize it, because it seems that it's these implicit biases that are still what we really have to work on.
So what's the question?
No, that's it.
No question.
We need the lights.
Yeah.
And now just concentrating on our remarks, I'll start off. Thanks to Dan Hansen, found a remarkable article in the Wall Street Journal bringing hidden biases into light. Big business teaches staffers how unconscious bias impacts decisions. Here is a quote from this must-read article. BAE, this is a huge corporation, requires that all 1,600 middle managers and executives take a two-hour class about unconscious bias. The company partly credits the management training for an increase in the number of women and people of color targeted for advancement last year. There are copies in the back. You have to read it because this is just one quote. They found that the personnel people in these huge corporations, not only this one, because of their biases, have not hired as many blacks and women as you would expect, and with this training, they do much better. This large defense industry business is using the exact same methods I have been referring to. This article could very well be the vehicle for a long-sought breakthrough in improving race relations. I will have more to say about it later. From my experience and from what the social scientists have said, is that what succeeds in the workplace can also succeed in personal relations. With practice, we could become freer to be just as relaxed with people of a different skin color as those who are of the same color as ourselves. Most importantly, to become aware of your biases when, for example, if you were a white person boarding an airplane and you see a dark-skinned man in a captain's uniform, and in a flash you wonder why the captain is not white. And another type of situation, if you're a black or white person, and when you refer to a black doctor or lawyer, you get an instantaneous negative message of their ability from your brain. Better still, Google Project Implicit and take one of the tests, which will give you an idea of the nature of any bias that you may have against the racial or ethnic groups. Once you've identified your bias, this is a time-tested method for gaining control of it. If the bias stares straight at you, wait a nanosecond. And as Malcolm Gladwell states in his book, The Blink, let the giant computer in your brain do its job of seeing the situation for what it is, freeing you to discard the bias as unwanted. I believe that just as the police have been trained to overcome their stereotypes when they think they are in a life or death situation, others of us can learn to control our biases. What I do when an unwanted image appears is I reject it instantly. I would like to tell you one instance where the process worked. I was sitting in a subway car. Several tall, very dark-skinned teenage boys and girls were screaming at each other. My first reaction was that they may be up to no good. A young adult, blonde, white woman was sitting next to me and looked very frightened. I looked at the teens again and realized the boys were teasing the girls just like my high school friends and I used to tease each other. The boys then moved from the inside of the car to the car doors and held them open. They threatened to come back inside and grab the girls and drag them out of the car with them. The girls screamed even louder. I looked at the boys and said in a loud voice, "You're not the only ones on this train." The white woman, on hearing my voice, was so frightened, she ran from her seat to the opposite end of the car. The boys looked at me in a respectful way and let the doors close. Having control of my biases has freed me to be as confrontational as I deem appropriate, no matter a person's skin color. For example, on the day Martin Luther King was assassinated, I was program director of the Union Settlement Youth Center in East Harlem. Called a meeting of youth and staff so that we could express our feelings about this tragedy. A black staff member told the youth that passive resistance died with King. I confronted him by saying that the word resistance represented a powerful tactic against bigotry, and it was succeeding. After the meeting, the youth asked me, the only white person on staff, to rap with them. Among the many places I took them was to a youth conference at which a black, highly respected social worker was saying to the large gathering that they should only read about black knowledge written by black scholars. I spoke up and said there was no such thing as black or white knowledge. There's only knowledge. A white staff person who I knew from I worked with him previously, came over to me and said I shouldn't have spoken up. I said I was standing up for my boys and for what was right. With that in mind, here's what I've done and will do. One, for those of you interested in learning more about hidden biases, there are copies of the compelling Wall Street Journal article and lists of resources in the back of the room. Two, to spread the word about the highly successful business and police training experiences, I will contact leaders in the know in the ethical culture movement, foundation, city and state governments, urging them to look at the evidence and seek funds for training more and more people. The aim would be hidden bias, consciousness raising, and the fostering of an educational campaign to unbind us from the shackles of our hidden demons and free us to relate to our fellow beings
with openness, frankness, and joy. Thank you.
Now he's done. I'm glad we waited. Dr. Phyllis Harrison-Ross is an adult and child psychiatrist, a pediatrician, a professor of psychiatry, researcher, clinical administrator, public servant, commissioner of the New York State Commission of Correction, and chair of its medical review board. She's chair of our social service board, among other things. She lives right across the street from this society in the Harper Lee Hall Co-op, where she is president. Please welcome Dr. Phyllis Harrison-Ross.
Comment on the issues of hidden biases from my point of view. I'm from Detroit, Michigan, immigrating to New York City in 1959 after completing medical school there. My father was a college, Morehouse College, roommate of the Reverend Dr. Daddy King, father of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King. As a member representing NYSEC and its affiliate, the United Social Services and Social Service Board, fiscal partner of All Healers Mental Health Alliance, I returned to Detroit last November to help facilitate a disaster response within their mental health community to help those affected by the bankruptcy there. I was feeling very guilty about having left in 1959 and also dealing with my Wonder Woman complex and save everything. I asked NYSEC member Nicola DeMarco to go with me as I also plan to meet with my first cousins who are white. Planning to meet these cousins, I had to face my old bugaboos, fear of being hurt physically and emotionally, and hopelessness because I am still not able to change the color of my skin. After 13 years of psychoanalysis plus some touch-up sessions along the way, writing books and articles on the subject, teaching cultural competency and proficiency in mental health, I learned that these feelings can lead to other crippling feelings and behaviors, anger, depression, failure to take chances to make friends, to grow, and to develop. I knew these white relatives when I was a child. A family decision resulted in our not seeing each other after I was 5 years old, until my mother made her transition, died in 2001, and I was then 65. I invited them to her memorial service. I felt that was the appropriate thing to do, and they came. And while I was courteous to them, I was distant. I was cool. I was aloof, while promising to keep in touch. It was not until 2010 that I invited some of them to my home when they said they were going to be visiting New York City. Even then, I needed the support of my NYSEC colleagues, some of whom are here today, Valerie, David, Abe, and these are friends whom I trusted to meet with them. So, in November, last November, I asked Nicola to accompany me to Detroit. While that evening in Detroit with my white family was pleasant, and I was charming, I still felt strange and almost dissociated. All of these white people, elders, adults, goofy teenagers, preteens, with my genes didn't make sense to me. On the other hand, when we visited with my Canadian, Afro-Native Canadian cousins, whom I had also not seen in years, I easily accepted them as blood relatives and felt very comfortable with them looking at family photo albums that had photos going back to the Civil War. I thank NYSEC for providing me an opportunity to have close white and colored friends and colleagues who are helping me to accept the reality of the worth of my skin color.
Thank you, Phyllis. That was an amazing story. And now Nicola Antonio DeMarco, the son of Italian immigrants, holds a law degree from Yeshiva University. He lived in Africa for 5 years as a development worker for the Peace Corps and the U.S. Agency for International Development. He is a member of our Social Service Board and assists Dr. Ross in her work at the New York State Commission of Corrections. He is also on a committee seeking reconciliation between Italy and Ethiopia. Please welcome Nicola DeMarco. Nicola.
I feel deeply honored to have been asked to join you here today. Thank you, Abe. Thank you, Dr. Ross. I am proud to be here with you and continue this process. As the son of Italian immigrants, my feelings and perceptions of race in America were partially formed in the flames of Newark, New Jersey's unrest of 1967. I was 3 years old when my parents joined thousands of working class and middle class whites fleeing the inner cities of America. I have no memory of those years in my early childhood, except for what my family tells me of our time there and photos. I believe my lack of conscious memory of those years has something to do with my parents' fears and anxieties transferred to me about Newark and race relations. I was raised in a 99% white neighborhood, suburban town, an hour south of Newark. Until I was 17, I had not seen a neighborhood of mostly middle and upper class black people. So until then, I believed almost all black people were poor. In my case, I often must fight my subconscious conditioning as a white straight male to be culturally proficient. This was particularly helpful when I served in the US Peace Corps in Africa. Being white, a white male to most people in that former apartheid nation of Namibia meant I had to essentially prove to the people around me that I was not a bigot and that I was truly a friend of the newly liberated black majority ruled society. My conditioning would have me thinking, why would I come to Africa as a volunteer if I were not here to help all of you and be on your side? But I actually needed to put myself in the shoes of Namibians who may say to me and other white volunteers, we just lived as slaves less than 8 years ago, and the people who enslaved us looked a lot like you and did so because they were white with America's help. I will believe you when you have lived among us, eaten among us, been to our weddings, our funerals, and listened to our needs and concerns, not only yours. My empathy efforts worked. I overcame my own conditioning, and the Namibian government, as well as Peace Corps, invited me back to serve, and I was unanimously elected chair of the Peace Corps Namibia Diversity Committee. I was asked to help train new Peace Corps volunteers on this issue. While serving, once in a while, I had some shocking wake-up moments. For example, when a young lady asked me, do white people suffer? Or when I was serving as a professor at the teacher's college and one of the students who had been waiting with me to see the dean asked if she could sit in the chair next to me. I said, of course, why not? She responded that under the old apartheid system, she was not allowed. I was shocked, to say the least, and assured her it was okay. And did she not realize that the old system had ended? She simply shrugged her shoulders, smiled, and sat next to me. And that was 2002. So we have a lot of work to do, and thank you, Abe, and thank you, Barbara, and Nysik, and all of you here today for starting this process.
Barbara Fennell is a longtime Upper West Sider who has extensive commitments to health, education, and housing concerns. She is a retired nurse and remains active in our Ethical Culture Society and local religious communities. Welcome, Barbara.
Good morning, and thank you for this opportunity to speak to you today. Overcoming hidden biases. I grew up in a heavily segregated urban environment in the 50s and 60s. We didn't interact with many people other than those who looked like us, so I was much more aware of the gradations in my own world. Lighter-skinned Negroes got the better jobs and usually were treated better by their white superiors. If you didn't pass the paperback test, you were not considered an appropriate candidate for membership in certain prestigious Negro clubs. Now, what is the paperback test? See this hand? If your skin was darker than a paper bag, you could be excluded from many of these clubs. The magazines played their part as well. Some of the advertisements in Ebony and Jet featured Nat Nola cream and lye-based hair preparation. Nat Nola was being massaged into the skin on a nightly basis in order to lighten the skin. The hair prep was to straighten naturally curly Negroid hair so that it could be straight, just like our betters. Believe it or not, these products were top sellers in their day. In an effort to lighten the race, many darker-skinned Negroes married lighter-skinned members of their own race. It was certainly true of my family. My cousin broke with his family in order to cross over. He married white and disappeared for 25 years. There was a saying that white was right, brown stick around, black get back. That saying has fallen aside now, but it was the norm pre-black power. Back then, if you called someone black, it was a fighting offense. Even as a young child, I was aware of the power of color. And it hurt. Social psychologists will tell us that in aping the attitudes of the superior race, members of the minority class try to elevate their standing, thereby reducing the pain of discrimination. The creeping insidiousness of prejudice actually encourages people to turn against their own in an attempt to feel superior. There's nothing more deadly or dispiriting than inculcated self-hatred. How did I overcome my own prejudices against members of my own race? Like so many others, I had no real knowledge of what constituted prejudice. Because of my status in life, I understood that blacks could be prejudicial. We were the victims, not the offenders. I would hear statements from time to time, I'll never go to a colored doctor. They don't know what they're doing. Or, uppity Negroes, just look at them, try to be white. I can also remember the wonder when everyone would rush to the television to see the light-skinned colored man announcing the weather or the local news. Talk about mixed messages. You can readily see the confusion in a growing and impressionable world. I remember when I came face to face with my own lack of knowledge about accomplishments of my own people. A history professor in college made a derogatory statement that I couldn't defend against. I had no real knowledge of my own people's accomplishments. I knew she was wrong, but what could I do? What I did was to educate myself. Through education, I discovered a whole world of pride and accomplishment. I interacted with people who looked like me and didn't look like me. I discovered that people really should be judged as individuals, not as groups. I learned that the politics of discrimination will be with us always, and that we have to be aware of fear, hatred, distrust of others, and to acknowledge that we have those same feelings within us. I also must credit my profession as a nurse, having to care for so many types of people, black, white, clean, smelly, takes you beyond yourself into another realm. My education continues through interactions with my fellow humans, through reading and discussion, through a maturing worldview, and I will tell you I'll be 73 in about 19 days. I find that I have less of a struggle these days with my own prejudices. And what would Martin say about ethical culture? I think he would say, break down these walls, get rid of these barriers, and let's get busy.
And pepper.
Hey, Pink Monster.
Yeah.
You're a monster, right?
Yeah.
And you know Tricky Monster, my neighbor, he's a monster.
Right.
So are you two like related?
What? Princeton? I find that racist.
Oh, I'm sorry, I was just asking.
Well, it's a touchy subject. No, not all monsters are related. You know, you should be much more careful when you're talking about the sensitive subject of race.
Well, look who's talking.
What do you mean?
Well, you're the one who's always complaining because your students are always cursing.
Yeah, well, they get that from rap.
You're a little bit racist.
Well, you're a little bit too.
I guess we're both a little bit racist.
Admitting it is not an easy thing to do.
But I guess it's true.
Between me and you, I think
everyone's a little bit racist. Sometimes doesn't mean we go around committing hate crimes. Look around and you will find no one's really colorblind. Maybe it's a fact we all should face. Everyone makes judgments based on race. Now, not big judgments like who to hire or who to buy a newspaper from.
No.
No, just little judgments like thinking that Mexican bus boys should learn to speak freaking English.
Right.
Everyone's a little bit racist today. So everyone's a little bit racist. Okay. Ethnic jokes might be uncouth, but you laugh because they're based on truth. Don't take them as personal attacks. Everyone enjoys them.
Okay.
Park is a plane going down. There's only one parachute, and there's a rabbi, a priest.
And a black guy! What are you talking about, Kate?
Ooh,
you were telling a black joke!
Oh, well, sure, Kate, but lots of people tell black jokes.
I don't.
Well, of course you don't if you're black. But I bet you tell Polish jokes, right?
Well, sure I do. Those stupid Polish people!
Guys, I'm the acrobat.
Racism!
Cool!
Recyclables. How many languages do you speak?